Sure. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, welcome to Green Lane Masjid. Tonight's lecture is part of the new series, The Major Sins in Islam. And the lecture is on murder and suicide, spying and cursing, and will be delivered by our Sheikh Abu Usama Hafidhullah. Brothers, just before we start, if you've parked in the car park blocking anybody, please move your car now. And if you parked on double yellow lines, please be aware that the ticket wardens do roam around at this time, so you don't get a ticket, and don't disturb lecture as well, please. Turn your mobile phones on silent. And if you can, the brothers at the back, I know there's a lot of people, but if you can get as close as possible together, it's one from the etiquettes of seeking knowledge, inshallah. So without further ado, inshallah, I'll hand it over to Sheikh Abu Usama.
أن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله والسلام عليه تسليما كثيرا أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Concerning the issue of the kabair, or the major sins in Islam. This is an issue that I believe that Muslim person should take some time out of his schedule, her schedule, to try to get some understanding concerning it and some fahm. It's not enough just for a person to say, let me try to stay away from the major sins, but there are a lot of things that are connected to this particular issue. And if that was not the case, then we wouldn't have had all of those ulama of al-Islam from the past who used to write about this issue. There are many books that have been written concerning the kaba'ir. Many, many. Probably the most comprehensive one and the widest one, the Awsa', an Ashmal book. It's a book that many people don't know about. It's the book of al-Imam Ibn Hajar Al-Haythami, who died in the year 974, Rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. He has a book that he called Al-Zawajir and Iqtiraf Al-Kabair. Al-Zawajir and Iqtiraf Al-Kabair. And as I mentioned, this book is the widest book, the biggest book, in which he mentioned over 300 and something major sins. He would bring the ayat of the Quran, a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and statements that the companions, ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, mentioned concerning those kabair, and the statements of what the ulama of al-Islam had to say about it before his time. So that's the biggest one. But the probably the most well-known one, the one that is mashhur, the one that is ma'roof, is the book by Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi. Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi, his book has been taken care of. Many of the scholars, students of knowledge, they came to take care of the book, unlike Al-Imam Ibn Hajar Al-Haythami's book. So probably those of you who speak Arabic, you want to get that book that's been serviced the best concerning Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi's book, then it is by none other than the Sheikh Mashhur Hassan, from the Talamid and the Tulab of Al-Imam Al-Albani. He came and he serviced the book by letting you know where every ayat is and every hadith is, and he added on with his own research. Also, Sheikh Al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahmatullahi alayhi, and giving nasiha to this ummah, he also has a small book, Kitab al-Kabair. It's not that big, but nonetheless, showing the importance that the scholars of Islam used to have in this particular issue, putting the Muslims on a footing where a person can know what are the kabair that need to be avoided because of what Allah mentioned in the Quran and the Prophet mentioned in the Sunnah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he took care of it. So the first point we want to bring to your attention is the ulama of al-Islam paid attention to this issue. And the scholars of al-Islam, past and present and in the future, inshallah, they're not like the regular people. They're going to pay attention to those things that need attention to be paid to it. So many ulama of al-Islam wrote about this book. It would be easy just to go right into the subject matter, but I think there are some really important issues that we need to know about the kabair in the way of being an introduction or like a muqaddama. You have to have it. You just can't go and start talking about murder just like that when everybody's sitting here knows the evil of murder. We are just going to be reminded about those ayat and about those ahadith that tell us about the danger of murder. But the issue of the kabair, the fiqh of al-kabair, the major sins, is an issue that we should have some kind of background concerning it, some kind of information concerning it. So in addition to the fact that the scholars of Islam, many of them wrote about this issue, many of them, only mentioned three books. The biggest one, by Imam Ibn Hajar al-Haythami. I mentioned the most famous one, the book of Al-Kaba'ir by Imam al-Dhahabi. And I would advise everybody to get that book. It's one of those books that should be in your library. It's in English and it's probably in every language that Muslims speak for the most part. We gave an example of Al-Imam, the Mujaddid Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Second issue is, some of the ulama of al-Islam, they had ikhtilaf between themselves whether or not we can say that there are major sins or minor sins. Some of the scholars said, no, you shouldn't say minor sins because every sin is a major sin from the angle you're disobeying Allah Azza wa Jalla. And he didn't create you or us to disobey him. He created us to worship him. He created us to do what he told us to do and to avoid what he told us to avoid. So if you say that there are major sins and minor sins, maybe a person will be mutahawin. He will be a person who sees certain sins as being small and insignificant, and no sin should be looked at that. The Prophet said in an authentic hadith, Iyakum wa muhaqqarat al-dhunub. Beware of minimizing the sins. Don't look at sins as being small. He said, because the example of the one who minimizes the sin is like the example of the one who, or example of a group of people who, this one, he goes to get a small piece of wood, just a twig. He goes to get a small one, small one, small one. Everyone went to get a small piece of wood, a little twig, just a little branch, the wooden branch. If everyone brought their small pieces back, they would be able to light a massive fire. So if a person were to look at the sins like that, it's small, it's small, it's small. Then the small sins are enough to destroy a person. So the scholars, some of them said, we shouldn't divide the sins into being major sins and minor sins. But what you should do, you should look at the one who you are sinning against, Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah's Kabir and Allah's Azim. But we can't fail to look at the Quran and at the authentic Sunnah, and we see in both of those sources that Allah Azza wa Jal, He made the taqseem of the sins, and He made the major sins and He made the minor sins. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, He made the major sins and He made the minor sins. So where's the proof of the Quran that says that there's a distinction? There are some sins that are major and some sins that are minor. Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Hujurat, وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمَ الْكُفْرُ وَالْفَسُوقَ وَالْعِسْيَانِ. Allah is the one who has made taste distasteful to you, detestable, something that you don't like or you shouldn't like. He made what is disliked to you, al-kufr, disbelief, and al-fasuq. And al-fasuq, in this ayah, the scholar said, it's the major sins. And al-isyan, al-isyan are the minor sins. So some of the ulama use that ayat from Surah Al-Hujurat is a dalil for the taqseem, that there are some major sins and minor sins. Because if Al-Kufr, Wal-Fasuq, and Isyan, if they were one and the same, then there would be no benefit, there would be no fa'ida in Allah mentioning those three things. So Kufr, disbelief, is clear. And Al-Fasuq, the ulama said in this ayat, it means the major sins. Al-Isyan are those mistakes that people make and those disobediences that they fall into that are from the minor sins. And we'll come to how to deal with them, inshallah. Another ayat in this introduction that shows us there's a distinction is what Allah mentioned in Surah An-Najm, the star, An-Najm. He said, تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى الَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِلَ الْإِثْمِ وَالْفَوَاحِشِ إِلَّا اللَّمَمْ. Those people who avoid the major sins and al-fawahish, they avoid the fahisha, all of which are from the major sins. الَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِلَ الْإِثْمِ. They stay away from the kabair, from the sins, and al-fawahish, and إِلَّا اللَّمَمْ, except those things that are from the major sins. They may fall into the major sins, because as the Prophet mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wasallam, kullu bani adam khatta'un wa khayru khatta'in at-tawwabun. All of Adam's children, they're gonna make mistakes. And the best of them are those who make tawbah after they make mistakes. So what are the mistakes that they can't afford or that they can't avoid falling into? There are the lamam that were mentioned in this ayat in Surah An-Najm. So that ayat is another proof, another indication that Allah made the taqseem and He made the distinction. So no one should come now and say, no, there are no major sins. All of the sins are the same. Just as everyone that's sitting in this audience is not the same. There are people in the audience who are from the awliya of Allah. May Allah make us all from them. There are people from the audience who are from the sabiqeen as it relates to doing good deeds. And then there are those people from the audience who are in the middle. Then there are people from the audience who are not from the middle. They're making dhulm to themselves. Same way, the sins are not on the same level. You have major sins based upon these two ayat of the Quran, and you have minor sins based upon these two ayats of the Quran. So in the introduction, we have to make that clear. Ikhtilaf between the scholars. Am I saying that those scholars before us who said there are no minor sins, they look at those ayat and they don't understand them? Allah is saying that they are major sins, but they're saying, no, there are no minor sins. No, those scholars, they understand. The distinction is there. But what they were trying to do was trying to get people to be careful of falling into this mistake of, I'm only going to do the minor sins. I'm going to look at it as a sin as being something that is small. Because enough small sins can destroy a person, as the Nabi said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Don't look at the insignificance of the sin, but look at the significance and the exaltation of the one who you are sinning against. From the Adilla as well is the third Dalil from the Quran, in Surah An-Nisa, that those scholars mention, that clearly show that there's a distinction, is what Allah told everybody. إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرْ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّيَاتِكُمْ. If you people only avoid, if you just avoid the major sins of what you've been prohibited from doing, if you avoid them, نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّيَاتِكُمْ, we're going to cause your other sins to be washed away, provided you stay away from the major sins. You've been created to sin, to make mistakes. There's no human being walking on the face of the earth. No sheikh, no human being. The awliya of Allah, they're going to make mistakes. The only one who didn't make mistakes and he was ma'asoom is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his brothers before him. And what mistakes they didn't make? They didn't make mistakes when it came to a da'wah ilallah, when it came to making halal halal and haram haram. But even the prophets and the messengers, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhim ajma'in, even they made mistakes, because no human being can avoid making mistakes. No one can avoid it. So the only one who can avoid it is the prophets and the messengers when it comes to a da'wah. They would never say what they were not supposed to say. They would never hold back what they were supposed to say. When they said what they said, it was what Allah wanted them to say. They would never say something that Allah wanted them to say. And that's really important, because, especially for you young people, but all of us, never go overboard in people, in this sheikh or that sheikh. Some of the people, I heard this with my own ears, they said today, 2014, 15, 16, sheikh so-and-so is ma'asoom. When it comes to a jarh wa ta'dil, he's ma'asoom. If he speaks about someone, he can't make a mistake. No one says that, except that he lost his aql, his intellect, or he's muta'assab. He's too overboard in his sheikh. Every human being, they make mistakes. Everyone. So in that ayat from Surah An-Nisa, Allah Azza wa Jal, he mentioned, if you people only stay away from the major sins, the kaba'ir, ma tunhawna anhu, if you stay away from those major sins that you've been prohibited for, nukaffir ankum sayyi'atikum wa nudkhilkum madkhalan karima, we will expiate and wipe away the minor sins and cause you to enter into the Jannah with an honorable entering. So those are three ayat of the Quran where Allah Azza wa Jalla came, he sent those ayat, and they clearly show there are kaba'ir and there are saga'ir. As for the hadith or the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for hadith ul haraj, there are many proofs to show from his authentic sunnah that there are major sins and there are minor sins. In an authentic hadith that was collected by al-Imam Muslim, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu said that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, as-salawatul khams, wal-jum'atu ila jum'ati, wa ramadanu ila ramadana, mukaffiratun lima baynahunna, idha ijtunibatil kaba'ir. He said that the five prayers that you make in the day, every day, fajr, dhur, asr, maghrib, shah, each prayer that you make, he said that each prayer, when you make the one after it, it wipes away the one that went before it. So the sins that Bani Adam made, since we prayed Salat al-Asr, now that we pray Salat al-Maghrib, Salat al-Maghrib, when you pray it, it will wipe away the mistakes that you made between Asr and Maghrib. The mistakes that the person makes between Maghrib and Al-Isha. Al-Isha, when he prays it, it will wipe away the mistakes that he made since Salat al-Maghrib. He said also, the Jummah prayer. When you perform the Jummah prayer, and then the following week you perform Jummah prayer, the mistakes that you make from one Jummah to the next Jummah, each Jummah will wipe away the sins that you perform for the whole week until you pray the next Jummah. And he said Ramadan to the next Ramadan is the same way. That if a person fasts a month of Ramadan, all of the mistakes that he makes leading up to the next following Ramadan, the new Ramadan will forgive and expiate all of the sins from the previous Ramadan with a condition, the hadith said. If the person avoids the major sins. So that hadith in Sahih Muslim clearly shows and it indicates that there are major sins and there are minor sins. And the minor sins are wiped away as a result of a person making five prayers every day. He asks his companion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiallahu anhum, if one of you had in front of his house a small stream that was going and flowing in front of his house, every day, five times a day, you got into that stream and you bathed yourself and you came into your house. He said, "Hal yabqa alayhi min dinis shay?" Will there remain any dirt on him if he got into that stream every day, five times a day? They said, "La ya Rasulullah." He said, "Kadhalik as-salat." He said, "The prayer is like that. It's like that stream. If you pray five times a day, each prayer that you pray, it will wipe away the sins that you did previously." It's one of the important aspects of keeping the prayer. Another hadith he mentioned concerning the salat, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, "Ma min muslim tahduruhu salatun maktubatun fayuhsinu wudu'aha wa raku'aha وَسَجُودَهَا إِلَّا كَانَتْ لَهُ مَكَفَّرًا مِمَا كَانَ قَبْلُهَا إِذَا اجْتُنِبَ إِذَا اجْتُنِبَتِ الْكَبَائِرِ." There is no Muslim, man or woman, no Muslim, Arab, non-Arab, rich or poor, knowledgeable, not knowledgeable, he can read, he can't read, there is no Muslim who, when the prayer time comes, he makes a good wudu, and then he starts to pray, and he makes a good salat. He makes ruku', he bows the right way. He makes sajda the right way. He does everything the right way, except that that salat is an expiation for the sins that went before him. So the salat, the Jummah, the Ramadan, the wudu, he told us in authentic hadith, if a person were to make wudu correctly, he learned how to make wudu. When he makes wudu and he blows or he spits the water out of his mouth, it goes down his arms. He said that water that falls away from you, it is your dhunub falling off of you. But what dhunub? The minor sins. So with this hadith, two things we want to mention about this hadith. Number one, we want to draw from it to show that there are major sins and there are minor sins. And those scholars who said that, no, we shouldn't make this distinction, they didn't reject and deny the distinction that Allah made in the Quran and the Sunnah. They said you shouldn't say that so that the individual wouldn't be mutahawin. He wouldn't be a person who sees sins as being small. Look at the one who you're sinning against. Don't just look at the sin and look at the sin as being small. You're sinning against Allah who did and gave you so much. That's the first thing. Second issue is, all of these things will be an expiation for the sins if the major sins were avoided. How can a person avoid the major sins if he doesn't know the major sins? So that's why those ulama of Islam, they wrote these books to give a person a knowledge, clear knowledge, an indication, what's major, what's major. If you know what's major, then you know what's opposite. You'll know what's minor. Which brings us to the third issue. First issue, scholars of Islam wrote about this issue. And if they wrote about it in such depth and detail, shows it's important. And that's the husn al-dhan that we have with the ulama of Islam. They don't waste time. They gave da'wah to Allah. They educated. They gave nasiha. They're not like the regular people. Second issue is, the Quran and the Sunnah makes the distinction. The third issue that we want to bring as it relates to understanding this issue, because there are a lot of things we need to understand before we even get into identifying the major sins. The third issue is, how many major sins are there? Are they a lot or are they only a few? I told you about the book of Al-Imam Ibn Hajar Al-Haythami. Not Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani, the one who gave the sharh of the ahadith in Sahih Bukhari. Ibn Hajar Al-Haythami, and died 974. In his book Al-Zawajir and Iqtiraf Al-Kabair, he mentioned over 300 major sins. Over 300. That's a lot. With dalil from the Quran and the Sunnah. Over 300. It's a lot. When some of the students were sitting with Abdullah ibn Abbas, he mentioned to them the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the hadith has been collected by Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim. The tremendous companion, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and may Allah be pleased with him and his father, he told the audience the hadith, famous hadith, اجتنبوا السبع المبيقات. Stay away from the seven major sins. The hadith said, Rasulullah's kalam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is muhaddid. He didn't say 8, 9, 10. He didn't say 1, 2, 3. He says, stay away, people, from the seven sins that will destroy you. Seven. And then he went on to mention them. Ash-shirk billah, as-sihr, qatl al-nafs. He went through all of them. When the people heard this hadith from Abdullah ibn Abbas, their sheikh at that time, may Allah be pleased with them, they said, so are the major sins seven? Are they only seven? Because Rasulullah said in this hadith, stay away from the seven major sins that will destroy you. He said, radiyallahu anhu, hiya ila sab'een aqrab minha ila sab'a. The major sins are closer to 70 than they are to 70, to seven. So this companion said, they said, are these the major sins? Are they seven? That's it? He said, no. They're closer to 70, not seven. He just mentioned in this hadith, stay away from the seven ones because these are the biggest of the biggest. And even with these being the biggest of the biggest, there are other sins that can be put in here because he didn't mention in those seven. He didn't mention the hadith when he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, akbaru kaba'ir al-khamru. On a hadith, he said, al-khamru akbar al-kaba'ir. وَأُمُّ الْخَبَائِثِ He said that intoxicants, khamr, weed, any type of drug, it is the biggest of the major sins. In the hadith of Abu Huraira, when he says stay away from the seven major sins, he didn't mention khamr. Khamr is not mentioned. But in the hadith by itself, he said, khamr is the biggest of the major sins. The biggest. So there are other major sins that were not mentioned in these seven. As a result of that, Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi, in his book that I told you was the most famous book of the Kaba'ir, he mentioned 76 major sins, similar to the statement of Abdullah ibn Abbas, Ridwanullahi alayhi. Ibn Abbas said what? When the people wanted to say, the people wanted to know and they asked him, are the major sins only seven? He said, no, not seven. Don't take this hadith. Stay away from the seven major sins that will destroy you. Don't take that as that's the limit. He said the major sins are closer to 70 than they are to that. So Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi in that famous book, Kitab Al-Kaba'ir, he mentions 76 in keeping with the kalam of Abdullah ibn Abbas and Ridwanullahi alayhi. Point number four. When we talk about the Kaba'ir, ya Muslim, when you want to learn and get fiqh, and understanding about this issue. We mentioned a few things. The ulama of Islam paid attention to it, so it's not a waste of time. You should busy yourself with learning and getting fiqh about this issue. Number two. Some scholars had ikhtilaf concerning it. And the ikhtilaf that they had is the ikhtilaf in the love. It's not an ikhtilaf in the haqq. It's an ikhtilaf in the meaning, in the statement. Because those scholars who said you shouldn't divide them into major and minor, they know these ayats that said they are kaba'ir. They didn't want people to minimize them. So they said, don't say that. All sins are serious. All sins can destroy you. All of them. The next issue is, how many are they? They are many. Whether they're 300, 200, 100, 77 is irrelevant. Stay away from all of the major sins. And you won't know the major sin until you study and you learn. You get that book of an Imam al-Dhahabi. Some of the kaba'ir, the major sins, they're just well known. We don't have to tell anyone. I don't think that homosexuality is a major sin. We don't have to tell anyone that. It's just clear. We know that. This ummah knows that. Although some people may lose their mind for one reason or another, and they try to make it minimize, every Muslim knows that. Everyone knows that. So we have to come to know about as many as possible to avoid them. The fourth point that we want to mention, Ikhwani, is how do we actually know that a sin is a major sin? How do we know that? How do we come to know that? We come to know that in three ways. You know that a sin is a major sin in three ways. If the sin doesn't have one of these three things connected to it, then it's not considered to be a major sin. The first one is at-tansis, an-nas. Allah said it was a major sin. The Prophet said it was a major sin. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. The man came and he said, Ya Rasulullah, what is the biggest of the sins? The number one biggest sin. He said, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an taj'ala lillahi niddan wa huwa khalaqaka. The biggest sin is for you to create a partner with Allah and He created you. You make a partner with Allah and He created you. How do you make a partner with Allah? By saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is equal to Allah. Equal to Allah how? He knows the unseen. He didn't die. You're making him equal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Making dua to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's with the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For you to make dua to Prophet Muhammad, asking him to ask Allah, you made Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam a nid or a partner. The man came and he made a simple mistake. He said, MashaAllah wa shitta ya Rasulullah. It is as Allah wants and as you want, ya Rasulullah. MashaAllah, we're all sitting here. We're all sitting here because Allah wanted it. It's from the irada of Allah. MashaAllah atayna. Allah wanted us to come and we came. Nobody else has anything to do with that. Even ourselves, we wanted to come and we came. But it was because Allah made it possible for everybody to come. You made it here. There could be, Allahu A'lam, I can't speak. I don't know, have knowledge of that. But there could be some people wanted to be here today. But when he was making preparations to make wudu to come, his kid got sick. And he had to go to the hospital with his kid right now, so he didn't come. So we didn't make it here because we wanted to be here. Allah made it possible for us to be here. So we say, MashaAllah wahdahu, by himself. Although you wanted to be here. What about someone who doesn't have anything to do with you, no connection, like Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah is in al-Madinah, in his masjid. He's in his grave, dead, in a way that Allah knows the life of the barzakh. He has nothing to do with us being here. Absolutely zero. So one man said, and this is the point. The man said, MashaAllah wa shitta ya Rasulullah. It is as Allah wanted and you wanted. Rasulullah became angry with him and he took his finger and he started poking the man in his chest. And he said, Aja'altani lillahi niddan. Did you make me a partner along with Allah, man? Say, MashaAllah wahdahu. That's the tawheed of our religion. We love the Nabi of Al-Islam. We respect him. We exalt him. We venerate him. He is the highest of the human beings, but we don't make dua to him. So this hadith goes to show what? This hadith goes to show that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a nas, a dalil, the Quran, the sunnah said, hey, this is a major sin. Ya Rasulullah, what is the biggest of all of the sins? The biggest of all of the sins. He said, for you to make a partner with Allah, and he created you. So we know that shirk is the biggest sin. He mentioned in the Quran, for an example, many ayat. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Tell them, oh my servants who have made a lot of sins. You made a lot of sins. You made a lot of them, big, small. Don't give up hope from the rahmah of Allah. Allah will forgive all of the sins that you do. Any and everything that you could possibly think of under the sun or above the sun, under the water. But there's one sin he won't forgive. He won't forgive that you make shirk. So when that ayat of the Quran tells us that Allah won't forgive shirk, we know it's a nas of the major sin. The other way that we know that a sin is a major sin, ikhwani, the other way that we know that a sin is a major sin is if there is a hadd. And a hadd means you get your hand chopped off, you lose your life. If you lose your life, if you do this, you do that, you get your hand chopped off. The Prophet mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, la yahillu dam imri'in muslim illa bi ihda thalath. It is not permissible to spill the blood of any Muslim except one of three things. The first thing he mentioned was if a person leaves his religion, if he apostates. So it becomes a bit strange, weird, that people come today and say, you can leave your religion. There's nothing in the religion that says you can apostate. No, that's not the case. You lose your life in the Islamic State under the correct circumstances if you apostate. So to leave the religion at ridda, it is a major sin because there's a hadd. Also, number two, if you kill somebody, who doesn't deserve to be killed, you're killed in turn. There is a hadd. So murder is a major sin. And number three, for an individual to do zina. So if there is a hadd, get your hand chopped off, any hadd, then that is a major sin. And lastly, we know that a major sin is a major sin if the description that is connected to it is serious. For an example, if Allah says the people who do this particular sin, they're from the brothers of a shaitan. They're from the awliya of a shaitan. إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. The people who waste are the brothers of shayateen, are shaitan. So some people, they have deen, they have akhlaq. They don't make zina, they don't do murder. They don't do riba even. They're very careful about doing riba. They try not to lie. They don't allow their children to watch TV and do this and do that and do that. And they're really on top of this issue. They're trying to be religious people. But the ayah said, those people who are wasters, they're from the brothers of a shayateen, of shaitan. The one who wastes, he's committing a major sin. Because the description is, the one who wastes is a brother of shaitan. So to throw food on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, in the garbage, in the bin, that's a major sin. To live beyond your means, to waste electricity, to waste gas, just to be a waster. That's from the major sins in Islam. So those are the three things that determine for us what's a major sin. There's a nas, kitab of the Quran, the sunnah. Number two, that particular thing has been described as it. Number two, that there is a wasf, there is a hadd. And number three, the description. They're the brothers of shaitan. Allah won't look at them, yawmul qiyamah. Allah won't purify them, yawmul qiyamah. They're going to be in the hellfire. And the reason for that, you know, these descriptions, the reason for that is, if the person was making minor sins, those ayat that we told you about earlier, and those hadith, if a person avoids the minor sins, then him fasting Ramadan, him making hajj, him making umrah, these things will clean him up, so he doesn't have to go to the hellfire, because he's only making the minor sins. Now he's only making the minor sin, but he's making the minor sins. As a result of making the minor sins, that's it. That's all he's doing. He would, Yom al-Qiyamah, when he dies, he'll be cleaned up because he did the minor sins. So the salat, the wudu, the sadaqah, walk into the masjid, all of those things that wipe away your sins. Getting sick, fitna, all of those things that we go through. They wipe away the minor sins. So if that's all he had, they will be wiped away. He'll go to the Jannah. But he won't go to the Jannah because there are major sins that he didn't take care of. They were not cleaned off of his scale. So the way that we get the major sins off of our scales, off of our backs, is to make tawbah. That's the way you have to get the major sins off of you, by asking Allah Azza wa Jalla to forgive you for all of your sins, especially the major sins. Those are a few of the more important issues that have to be part of this introduction. And there are other issues that can be mentioned, but I deem them, these four, to be from the most important. Now we come to the issue of murder. Murder is a major sin, clearly. Everybody, I don't think anybody sees that as a small thing. Everybody, except the people that Allah took out of their heads, the aql. People like Daesh, people like Shabab, Boko Haram, people who see spilling blood as being a simple and an easy thing. When it comes to spilling people's blood, a person has to think a million times before he embarks upon such an endeavor, because spilling blood is a big thing in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Killing people unjustly is a major sin. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, من قتل نفسا بغير نفسا أو فساد في الأرض فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا. Anyone who kills a person, any person, unjustly, and he makes fasad, evil in the earth by doing that, then it is as if he has killed all of the people. So this ayat right here by itself, it didn't say murder was a major sin. That's how we know a sin is a major sin. The Quran and the Sunnah said it. This ayah didn't say it. This ayah didn't mention anything about a hadd. But this ayah has a description that the one who kills a person unjustly and he makes fasad in the earth by killing that person unjustly. What's the fasad? He killed that person, so he left his wife as a widow. He killed that person, so he left his children as orphans. He killed that person, so he took a person's child away, his son, his daughter away. That's fasad. فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. It will be as if he killed all of the people and he killed one person. So that's the description that helps us know murder is a major sin. Although there are ayat and there are a hadith that tell us murder is a major sin. There are ayat and a hadith, murder is a major sin. And there is a hadd for murder. But this particular ayat is just giving us this description. So, murder is a major sin in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as I mentioned to you in the hadith, he told the people, اجتنبوا السبع المبيقات. Stay away from the seven major sins. He mentioned first, الشرك, which is bigger than murder. He mentioned السحر, magic. And number three, he said, وَقَتْلُ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. To murder someone who doesn't deserve to be murdered. He mentioned that as number three. So there's a hadith of the Prophet telling us murder is a big issue. He said another authentic hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, showing the magnitude and the severity and the seriousness of murdering people. قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ wa sallam, لَا يَزَالُ الْمَرْءُ في فسحة من دينه ما لم يتند بدم حرام. A person will always have an opportunity in his religion to go to Jannah, no matter what he did. He fell into riba, fell into He'll always have a chance to be forgiven, to go into Jannah, as long as he doesn't murder someone unjust. If he murders someone unjustly, then there's a big problem. A big problem. I'm amazed at how many of the people, alhamdulillah, in our community, and this is a good thing, but it just shows the expertise of a shaitan. Many of the people say, alhamdulillah, I didn't murder anyone. I'm not a murderer, alhamdulillah. But in actuality, leaving off prayer is worse than murder. Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim, Al-Imam Ibn Hazm Al-Andalusi, they said that it was the ittifaq and the ijma', the ulama of Islam. The scholars have a unanimous position that leaving off prayer is a bigger sin than murder. Because a person can murder someone, but he's still a Muslim. Whereas if a person abandons prayer, the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, tasleeman kathira, al-aqd alladhi, al-ahd alladhi baynana wa baynahum as-salatu, man tarakaha faqad kafir. The difference between us and them, non-Muslims, is the prayer. Anyone who abandons the prayer, he has disbelieved. So to abandon the prayer is kufrun billah. And shirk and kufr is the biggest sin. Allah will forgive a person for murder. He may not even go to the hellfire. There was a man from Bani Israel that killed 100 people. And from the 100 people that he killed was an abid, zahid. There was a righteous man, at least one that we know of from the hadith. 100. And Allah forgave him. But if an individual, he made ship with Allah and he died on kufr and he was a doctor and he operated on 100 people and Allah helped him to save their lives. The doctor who's a kafir, Allah helped him to save their lives doing transplants, heart transplants, this, that, whatever it is. That individual, because he died on kufr billah, he's going to be in the hellfire. Allah won't forgive him. So now, murder is a big thing, but bigger than murder is abandoning salah. If someone were to come to one of us, and we have daughters, we have sisters, people want to marry our daughters, our sisters, we're going to ask the people, tell me about him, who is his friends, what's his education, what's his situation. If we hear this guy, he drinks khamr, and this guy, he does this, he does that, we're not going to marry him, and rightly so. But if it said, no, he has a good job, he doesn't drink, he doesn't do this, he doesn't do that, but he doesn't pray, some of us will marry him to our daughters, when in fact, the sin of not praying is bigger than the sin of drinking khamr. But that's where salat is with the ummah today. The people of the past, salat used to be the main thing with them in judging people. What is his prayer looking like? People today, it's one of the last things that we ask about, marrying someone off to someone who doesn't pray. Ala kullin. Murder is a major sin, based upon the Quran and based upon the authentic sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Before we move on to the next issue, because murder was the topic of last week's discussion, we have to add two other topics for this week, inshallah. Before moving on, though, we have to mention, all murder is not the same. All murder is not equal. Just like all salat is not the same. All zakat is not the same. All hajj is not the same. All umrah is not the same. Making umrah in Ramadan is like making hajj with the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. The salat that is fard is not like the salat that is from the nawafil. Qiyamul Layl is not like the salat during the course of the day. All prayer is not the same. All people are not the same. Your mother is not like your father, and your father is not like your kid, and so forth and so on. So there are some people who, if they are murdered, it's more severe. Like what Allah said about Bani Israel, يَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ. They kill the prophets without any haqq. They used to slaughter their prophets and the messengers. And the thing about Bani Israel is that Bani Israel used to have a number of prophets living at the same time. They would kill all of them at the same time. All of them. And the ayah said, بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ. They killed them without just cause. The question that begs to be answered is, is there a just cause where a prophet could be killed? Because someone may be killed in a just cause. The blood of the Muslim should not be spilled except in one of three instances. One of them, killing someone بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ. He doesn't deserve to be killed. This ayah said, they killed the prophets without the haq. Is there a way that the prophet should be killed with haq? Under no circumstances should a prophet be killed. The prophet is coming and he's calling the people to what Allah wants them to do. So therefore, if you kill him, you're the worst person. And if he kills you, you're the worst person still because of your niyyah. Your niyyah was to kill the prophet. So they'll get the worst punishment, Yawm al-Qiyamah. The meaning of they killed the prophets without the haq is, in their religion, they knew that killing was not permissible. Killing regular people was not permissible. من أجل ذلك كتبنا على بني إسرائيل أنه من قتل نفسا بغير نفس أو فساد في الأرض فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا. Because of this issue, we wrote and prescribed upon Bani Israel, anyone who kills someone unjustly, it would be like he killed all of the people. So the people of the past, they also knew that murder was a serious indiscretion and a serious mistake. Also, ikhwani, from the people who it's more serious to kill them, murder is a problem, but killing some people is worse than others. Killing innocent people. People don't have anything to do with the problem. They don't have anything to do. They're just innocent. Like the newborn child. In that hadith that I told you, they say, Ya Rasulullah, what is the worst sin? He said, to make along with Allah a partner and he created you. It's the worst sin. The man said, and then after that, what's the worst sin? He said, أن تقتل ولدك خشية أن يطعم معك. That you kill your child out of fear that he's going to eat your food. You're afraid of being impoverished. We're not talking about the person who's taking birth control and the child doesn't come. We're talking about the individual who the child has been decreed and the lady is pregnant and then they get an abortion. That murder is from the worst murders because those individuals are innocent. And that's in the Quran. That's what our children memorize when they go to the madrasa. Allah Ta'ala mentioned, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ, the newborn girl, she's going to be asked, why were you killed? Kufar of Quraysh, if they had birth, the mother gave birth to a baby girl, they were taken, they would bury it alive. Abortion, killing kids. And they don't deserve to be killed. So innocent people, whether they're children, whoever they happen to be, it's worse than killing someone who, the individual who, maybe he's in a bad place and as a result of the bad activities that he's doing, he gets killed. He doesn't deserve to get killed, so it's a major sin, but he's not like the one who was innocent. From those people who killing them is more severe, is killing a Muslim. Killing a Muslim is a big thing, it's a big issue. One of the ayahs in the Quran, Allah Ta'ala mentioned, وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمْ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَغَدِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ وَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابٍ عَظِيمًا. Anybody who kills a Muslim intentionally, a believer intentionally, then Allah will be angry with him and Allah will curse him and Allah is prepared for him a grievous punishment. Rasulullah said in an authentic hadith about killing the Muslim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَقَتْلُ مُؤْمِنْ أَعْظَمُ إِنْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ زَوَالِ الدُّنْيَا. Killing a Muslim unjustly is greater in the sight of Allah than the whole dunya leaving. So the point is, every murder is not the same. From the worst murder is suicide. And this talk was supposed to be about the major sin of murder and suicide. From the worst murder is suicide. In the Quran, it's been established, وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Allah owns the mulk, the dominion of the heavens and the earth. Everything in the sky, everything on the earth belongs to Allah. So everybody here belongs to Allah. Everyone's life belongs to Allah in its totality and its completeness. Your life, my life, partially belongs to us. It's not all mine. I don't really even control all of it. Because when Allah wants it to leave, it's going to leave me. It's going to leave me. Just like that. Even if I'm the most careful human being on the face of the earth. If Allah wants my life to leave, it's going to leave me. So he gave everybody his life and his temporary. And we have to take care of it to the best of our ability. You can't kill yourself. You can't kill yourself a slow death. And you can't kill yourself once and for all. So the Nabi, he warned his companion, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And he told the people, anyone who kills himself by stabbing himself, he'll be in the hellfire stabbing himself forever like that. That'll be his issue until Yawmul Qiyamah. And then when Yawmul Qiyamah comes, he'll be put in the hellfire. Anyone who takes poison and he kills himself with poison, using poison, same thing that's going to happen. Anyone who throws himself over a high mountain, he'll throw himself off the high mountain in a way that Allah knows is reality until Yawmul Qiyamah. And then Yawmul Qiyamah, Allah is going to put him in the hellfire if he pleases to do that particular issue. So killing a person killing himself is considered to be from the major sins in Al-Islam. And no one should ever allow himself to be so dark in a particular place where he thinks that the only way out is to murder himself. As I said many times, as long as you're on this top of the earth, you're on this side of the ground, you have a chance to make tawbah, to be forgiven. You have a chance. Whatever the issue is, whatever the issue is. So the persons that the Prophet ﷺ refused to pray the salat of janazah upon, one of them is the man who killed himself. A man committed suicide. It was time to make the janazah. They told the Prophet that man killed himself when he asked, what did he die from? They said he made al-intihar. He killed himself. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the people, you pray over him. I'm not going to pray over him. And the reason why he didn't pray over him is not because he's a kafir. Not because he died on other than al-Islam. Not because he'll never go to Jannah. He wanted to let the community know. The community doing his time. He wanted to let them know. Killing yourself is a major thing. And if anyone from amongst you kills yourself, I'm not going to pray over you. Because if I pray over you, this is a virtuous thing. You'll go to Jannah, inshallah. So, Ikhwani, especially during this time we read, I mean, I personally can't relate to this, but I know it's true, but I can't relate to it, but it's true. The kid is in school, and the kid, boy or the girl, they want to be popular, and they want to fit in, but the other kids don't allow him or her to fit in, and they bully the kid. The kid goes somewhere and hangs himself. I personally can't relate to that. Because I'm not going to kill myself as a kid doing that. I just can't relate to that. But that's me. That's you. Some people don't respond to that negativity in that way. It's a natural thing to want to be accepted. So being bullied causes some kids in this society to kill themselves. Muslim kids. I'm not talking about kuffar only. Muslim kids, as a result of being bullied. So we got to be on top of this issue. When we say to our brothers and our sisters, our nephews and our nieces, don't kill yourself over something like that. I can guarantee you there are more people who love you, care about you, than those people who are giving you a hard time. And usually those people who are bullies, there's something wrong with them. And although I don't like that violence on the internet, you know that Facebook they be sending you. You can see in the Facebook where it's a lot of violence. They can say, world star, when people be getting beat up. But when the bullies get it back, I can't say I like it, but I don't have anything to say. When the bully get it back, the bully is bothering the kid, and then that kid turns around and does something to the bully. Every bully should be taught the lesson, don't bully people. So the point is, you young people, don't be like that. And for our older people as well, some people have so many problems in their lives that they feel and they think the only way out is murder. That's from a shaitan. Seek refuge in Allah from the shaitan, as he mentioned in the Quran. If the shaitan touches some people, they make the dhikr of Allah, and lo and behold, suddenly they can see aright. Last person that we want to mention concerning murder, ikhwani, from the people, the murder in them is not like murdering anybody else, is what's known in al-Islam as the mu'ahid. The mu'ahid is an individual who has a contract from Allah or his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. A contract, an agreement, an understanding from the Muslims that you're going to protect them and they're going to be safe from you. People used to come to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam and they would be non-Muslims and they would say, Ya Muhammad, I'm asking and I'm seeking your protection. Rasulullah would give him there is protection. Different individuals from his community, one individual would give him protection. One lady, Hani, Fath Mecca. When the Nabi conquered Mecca, a non-Muslim, when the Prophet was coming to conquer Mecca, the non-Muslim went to Hani. The non-Muslim said, Hani, you know me from Jahiliyyah. You know me. Just give me your protection. Don't let the Muslims harm me. Hani said, you have my protection. You have it. You have it. When the men heard that from the Muslims, they said, man, we're not listening to that. It's a woman giving you protection. You're done, son. We're going to get you. When the Prophet heard about that, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, anyone who Hani gave her protection, he's protected by me. And the Prophet didn't allow them to harm that man because a Muslim lady gave him her protection and she had to stand with her word. So this is an issue that's been mentioned in a number of ayat in the Quran. When ahadu min al-mushrikeen istajaraka fajiru hatta yasma' kalam Allah. If one of those people from the polytheists, if they come to you, Ya Muhammad, seeking your protection, give them protection. Give it to him. Although he's a mushrik, so that he can hear the kalam of Allah. So the mu'ahid in Tunis, in Morocco, in Egypt, in Saudi Arabia, in Somalia, in any country where there are Muslims. Non-Muslims come to our country to do what? They come to our country to enjoy the weather. They come to our country to go on the sawahil, on the shore. Yeah, they got bathing suits on and all that, drink khamr, all that. Yeah, they got all of that. They do all of that. But nonetheless, they've been given the protection and the okay by the Muslim government to come. And they're there doing their thing in the hotel, whatever. And then the Muslims come while they're in that state and they start killing them. That's from the biggest of the sins in al-Islam. Prophet Muhammad said, anyone who does that, kills someone like that, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said he would not enter. He said he would not smell the fragrance of paradise, although the fragrance can be smelled from 40 seasons away. Not he won't enter into the paradise. He won't smell it, although it can be smelled from a far, far distance. And that's because that is ghadr. That is khiyana. That is something that is not allowed to do to be done in al-Islam. So when we come here as well, we come to these countries right here, and we have an agreement that we're going to obey the law, we're going to be upright citizens. It's not permissible for people to do what's being done in Belgium and in France and these other places. It's not our religion. It's something that is outside of the realm of al-Islam. Now we move on to what was supposed to be, inshallah, today's issue, and that is the issue of spying. Allah mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Hujurat, وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ مِنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا. He said, don't spy on one another. And after mentioning not spying, he said, and don't backbite one another. Would one of you like to eat the dead flesh of his brother? So spying, a jasus, spying was mentioned along with ghiba. Ghiba is a major sin, and that's why spying has been put with a major sin. It's important. It's not permissible to spy on people. It's from a major sin. How do we know it's from the major sin? I told you, you know a major sin. Allah said it's major. The Prophet said it's major, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because there is a had connected to it. Or because there is a wasf, a description. He said in an authentic hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, tasliman kathira, لا تؤذوا عباد الله ولا تعيروهم ولا تطلبوا أوراتهم فإنه من طلب أورة أخيه مسلم طلب الله أورته حتى يفضحه في بيته. He said, don't bother, don't annoy the Muslims, don't annoy your Muslim relatives, don't annoy your Muslim neighbors. Don't annoy the ibad of Allah. Don't annoy people. Don't be a nuisance to people. He said, and don't talk bad about them. Don't talk bad about their lineage. Don't talk bad about the way they speak English. Don't talk bad about their failures, about their children, the way they dress. They're tall, short, skinny. Don't ta'iruhum. Don't talk bad about Muslims at all. And don't try to expose their nakedness, their aura. And that's what spying is. Spying is trying to find out what people are doing, trying to find out his nakedness. His nakedness is his secret. It should be covered up. It's not for you to come or for me to come to try to uncover his or her nakedness. He said, anyone who tries to uncover the nakedness of a Muslim, Allah is going to uncover your nakedness, even if it is in the privacy of your own home. In your own home. So it's not permissible to spy on people. It's not permissible in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The only time, ikhwani, that it is permissible to spy on people, pay attention to this, is if a person is in position of authority and he has a just cause, then he can spy. But if the person is not in a position of authority, he shouldn't spy. For an example, I'll give you an example. I don't have any authority over anybody here other than my little man's right there. I don't got no authority over anybody. But I have skills with the internet and IT. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to break into your computer. And when I break into your computer, I'm going to see what you're doing. I don't like you. I'm going to break in. I'm breaking your computer. I'm going to find out information. That's haram in the deen of Allah. That's haram. And there are many people who are part of that, Muslims and non-Muslims. Some Muslims, it's their job to do that, to rip people off. Can't spy on people. Can't go to a man's garbage, his bin, and then sift through his stuff to try to find out what's going on. And we have to be people on top of issues like that. Your regular garbage, your regular trash. People come at nighttime and they take that out. I don't want to be stereotypical. I don't think all Romanians are bad. That's racist and not permissible. I don't want someone to say all Muslims are bad. All Muslims are not bad. All Romanians are bad. But there are some people. They will come in your garbage at nighttime, take out of that garbage stuff. Some of it they'll keep it, they'll use it, they don't care. And some of it they'll go through your stuff to rob you, to steal your identity. That's the time that we're living in. So therefore, I have to be careful. I'm talking about the people who are prone to getting ripped off and getting oppressed. As it relates to today's dars, in terms of spying, the Muslim can't go and spy on people. It's not permissible. It's a major crime. It's a major sin. But as I told you, the one who was in a position of authority, at the war of Uhud, the battle of Uhud, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't want to confront the kuffar. So he built a big trench to prevent them from jumping over. If anyone jumped over, they can deal with them. And when he built the trench, he told one of his companions, you, go over on the other side and act as if you're from them and let me know what's going on. And that man went over, he got in there, and he was figuring out how many men are here. How many weapons do they have? What is their game plan and what they're trying to do? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to do that. Now Muslims of Quraysh, they said, everybody, try to figure out who's next to you. Because they didn't want to be giving their secrets to the enemy. Everybody, kuffar said this, everybody, look at who's next to you. That Muslim who the Prophet sent over there to spy, he took the initiative and very quickly grabbed the man next to him and said, who are you? Who are you? Put him on the defensive. So that man wouldn't put him on the defense, say, who are you? He said, who are you? As if he was from Quraysh. So the Nabi allowed that. So the one who is in position of authority, if he wants to spy on people, over here we heard that house over here is a house where they're doing this, they're doing that. The one in position of authority, he can send the cable man, the telephone man, he can send someone to look to spy on them. Because he's an authority. Similar to that, the mother and the father. The mother and the father can look into the personal effects of their children. Do you know, Ikhwani, in talking about in Al-Islam, the privacy of each individual? We have privacy, right to privacy. We can't just go into our mother and father's room at any time in this religion. There are times you shouldn't go because they have the right to their privacy. But anyway, there's a hadith that the Prophet told us, he prohibited us. He said, no one shall open the book of another man without his permission. He has a book and you come and say, mashallah, I'm going to get that book. I like that book. Usul Sunnah, oh man, I want to get that book. You shouldn't pick that book up and open that book just like that. You should say to him, you give me permission to open that book? What could he possibly find in that book if he opened it up? That's a problem. Anybody know? Anybody got an idea? Anybody? Anybody? What can possibly be in a man's book? He has a book right here about the deen. It's right here. You come and you say, oh, mashallah, you've been, what's been going on? You've been lying, everything is okay, what's going on? What's happening with you? You pick his book up and you just open it without his permission. What can be in his book? What? Anybody know? Picture of his wife can be in that book. Picture of his daughter can be in that book. Picture of the girl that he wants to marry can be in that book or something like that, or someone he just married. It's not for you to open up his book without him saying, yeah, you can pick up my book. Go to the person's library and you just start pulling out books like that and you start opening up the stuff and going people's stuff. It's not from the edab of Al-Islam. That's his haq. You sit in this car. You sit in this car. And when you get in this car, he goes, he's going to put air in the wheel. And you start opening up the dashboard right here. And you start opening up the thing right here. That's not your business. That's his business. Or taking people's telephones and going through people's telephones. Not his business. The mother and the father, they're in positions of authority over their children. It's permissible for them in what is reasonable, with what is reasonable, with what is reasonable. They have just cause to keep them honest, to keep on top of their situation. It's permissible to look in their stuff. With what is reasonable. Only with what is reasonable. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, in the issue of spying, Ikhwani, he mentioned as a dalil for the impermissibility of spying, he mentioned the story of the companion Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a, Ridwanullahi alayhi. He was the companion who Prophet Muhammad was going to go to fight the Kufar of Quraysh. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and this particular companion, Hatib, he wrote a letter to the Kufar of Quraysh, telling Kufar of Quraysh, Muhammad is coming to get you, get prepared to get him. So Jibril told the Nabi, this man sent news, it's not a sneak attack anymore. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi brought the part of the hadith where Umar said, when the Prophet found out what he did, Jibril came and said, Hatib wrote a letter to inform them. When the Prophet told the companions what happened, he said, go get Hatib. They brought him. When they brought Hatib, Umar took his sword. I said, Ya Rasul, let me kill him. Let me chop his head off. Because he's a munafiq. He was spying on the Muslims. He was spying on us. And he shared our secret with the non-Muslims. The Prophet said to Umar, he was from the people of Badr. He fought. He was a companion who fought, participated in Badr. Maybe Allah told them, do whatever you want to do. I forgave you because it was such an important war, and he participated in that. And Hatib is in Jannah, and we say, radiyallahu anhu, may Allah put us with Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi brought this dalil to show the impermissibility of spying, because when people spy, spying is not on the same level. There is the spy who spies on the Muslims to make fitna and fasad. They get people deported. They get people in a position where they turn their lives upside down. The spies in the community. They're not kuffar, they're not munafiqeen. I don't say that they're outside the religion, but they spy on the Muslims. They spy on people who are working with them. They go back to the manager and they tell the manager, he did this, he did that, he did that. So whenever you spy on people and you cause corruption in the earth, then it's more severe. Like the ayat of the Quran said, Allah Ta'ala mentioned, إِذَا تَوَلَّى سَعَى فِي الْأَرْضِ لِيُفْسِدَ فِيهَا وَيَهْلِكُ الْحَرْثُ وَالنَّسْلُ وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَسَادِ. So if a person's spying creates a lot of mashakil, a lot of issues, it's even more. So spying is not permissible. But we will say it is permissible for the father to say to his son, give me a mobile phone. It is permissible for him to say, let me see what sites you've been going to on the internet with what is reasonable. Last thing, and we finish with this, inshallah, is the issue of cursing. We have the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, laysa al-mu'min bit-ta'an wala bil-la'an wala al-fahish al-badhi. The believer is not a person who criticizes other people, nor does he curse other people, nor does he talk in a vulgar way. He's not a vulgar person, a person of vulgarity. That shows impermissibility of being a person who is cursing and swearing. لا يستقيم إيمان عبد حتى يستقيم قلبه ولا يستقيم قلبه حتى يستقيم لسانه. The slave will never be a religious person until his heart is upright. And his heart won't be upright until his lisan is upright. So if a person is given to swearing and cursing, and he does that a lot, or when he gets angry, he goes crazy. Maybe he doesn't curse a lot, but when he gets angry, he starts to sway, he starts to curse, then there's a problem with his iman. There's a problem with his heart. No matter how religious he or she thinks they are, there's a problem with those particular issues. So these are the three things that we want to mention, Ikhwani, today, inshallah, azza wa jal. We're going to have a few more presentations from different brothers. If you brothers have, how much time we have for the adhan? Like 5 minutes? All right. We have 10 minutes, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, until the adhan of Salat al-Isha. The Salat itself. Did they make the adhan? There's no adhan, huh? All right, then. نكتفي بهذا القدر إن شاء الله تعالى because it's time for the adhan and we have to get ready for the salat. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على النبيين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Doctor, you okay? Brothers and sisters, next week's lecture will be